You are hip hop, we are hip hop, and this is the I Am Hip Hop podcast. As you can see, we are in a completely different space right now for you YouTube listeners, and we're in for a treat today. We've got not one, but two very, very special guests for our Women's Month podcast special. Can we give it up for Janine Francois? I'm missing my like sound effects. And we need some bashment horns, like, in it. And Sophia Thakur. We gotta do a click for the poet right here. So we've got Janine. If you'd like to say a little bit about what you do in like a little snappy sentence.
Yeah, so my main bread and butter, or how I pay my bills every month, I'm an academic, so I teach at University of Art, but I'm also a culture producer, so I put on events, curate exhibitions, and I also do a lot of work with institutions around like structural racism.
Okay, and Sophia?
Pale in comparison. I'm a writer, so performance poet, author, songwriter, copyright, just all things sort of word related.
We love to see it. I feel like everyone at the moment is kind of like multidisciplinary. Yeah, like yeah. No one wants to be boxed into like kind of one category.
It's a great
like time. Have you like what was your kind of journey into thinking you're going to branch out into different art forms or different kind of hustles, if that makes sense?
I got bills to pay.
Like, no, for real, I actually have bills to pay.
It's so real.
The money's real. One, like, that is literally genuinely a thing, but also I just feel like I had very different backgrounds before even working in universities. I worked as a youth worker for 10 years, working with young women affected by sexual violence. So I'm always basically doing teaching. To me, it isn't any different to being a youth worker. It's about care frameworks, putting on exhibition with artists. Often marginalized artists is the same work. It's about a care framework. So I think for me, the running thread is about how do you care for people in different environments, and how do you kind of create a space of community? And that is kind of what I think is a common theme between these random things that I do.
And would you say for you, Sophia, it's the same? I feel like community is also quite a strong, like, reoccurring motif in a lot of your poetry.
Yeah, for sure. That's really beautiful, that care, sort of the thread that weaves everything you do together. That's incredible. Yeah, I think words more than care. I care about words and I care about people, but I think it was learning that poetry exists inside so many different spaces. We just don't really identify it as poetry initially. So I think when we're young, we're exposed to poetry in one way, which might be stanzas or anthologies or proverbs, but it's in copywriting, it's in marketing, it's songwriting, it's working with brands and just how they word something on like a flyer or on one of their products. So I think, again, I think when you love something enough, you're going to try and find a way to monetize as much of it as possible. So I definitely learned poetry is something that is separate from an anthology, and saw it as the ability to sort of pull a message out of something with words in a powerful way. And that forced me into loads of different spaces, from really corporate spaces to really, really commercial spaces. So working with like the Nikes or the MTVs, but then also working with like the Cancer Research, and then also obviously writing a book, but then my main thing is still performance poetry. But I think recently I've dabbled a lot more in music and songwriting, because I think it just challenges you as a writer as well. I think it just makes you a more careful writer, because you have less space to deliver the same potency. And with music, it's just a little bit more fun as well.
And you brought up like a really amazing point as well. You were saying about how that people kind of don't recognize that poetry exists everywhere, and I feel that that's a really reoccurring theme in hip hop as well, that people don't recognize that a rapper is a poet.
Yeah.
Have you found, as a spoken word artist, that you could you cross over into rap? Have you found that rappers can cross over into spoken word?
Definitely both. I don't call it rap, but Oh, yeah, I mean, it's rap. When I'm working with musicians, I played Jazz Cafe the other day, and half of my set was what we call lyrical poetry in the poetry world, which is basically rap. And yeah, it's very hard not to, especially when it's the main thing that you consume. I remember when I was in a really R&B space a few years ago, my poems, like most of them were like love or about family, but they had a similar sentiment that you would find in R&B. And then I remember when I was in third year, I think, Stormzy's album came out, Gang Signs and Prayer, and I hadn't listened to UK rap in ages. I grew up on like really old school American hip hop, like the Big L's and the Big Puns and the Sci Highs. And I hadn't listened to UK rap in ages, and I listened to it, and then everything I wrote sort of that year past that point was just really, really lyrical, like really, really rap. Like, I remember once I got given a book that Tupac wrote, A Rose from
Concrete.
Yeah. Rose Concrete, Tupac. I'm starting with that. And it was sort of like, it was like a stream of consciousness almost. It was his thoughts, some in poem form, some in rap form, some just thoughts, quite freehand. And one thing I found, especially when I write for rappers, they love the freedom of poetry because you're not sort of constrained to like a beat or a bar. You can just say everything you've wanted to say or want to say. But then a lot of poets I know really enjoy the constraints of a song, like a bridge and a bar. Otherwise you can go on for ages. But I suppose it's the art thing. You sort of love what your main practice is, your main practice isn't a lot of the time as well. But yeah, I mean, poetry and rap are this exact same thing.
Yeah. And for you, Janine, as well, like as an academic, and because you're like a kind of academic and because obviously you're a cultural studies academic as well, and you you're gonna launch your hip-hop studies. So with that as well, thinking about hip-hop being kind of like a valid field of academia, what's been the challenges in that? And like,
it's interesting with starting hip-hop cultures as a module. So technically there was no challenge, like it got through like fine. I was ready for a fight, like I was ready to like beat down people, you know? But like, yeah, but like, this is a great idea. I'm like, yeah.
What's been really hard is actually how do you condense but also teach something that's also experiential.
Like, how do you teach something when you're listening to something or you're reading something or experiencing as like there's a theory behind that, and it's, you know, so something about like with hip hop, it is teachable, but it's also so experiential, and it's so how you vibe with other people. It's about the spontaneity of the moment. It's all these things that I think we're still trying to figure it out. And I think with a lot of like black expression in terms of how black people commune and create, a lot of it is intangible, like it's just it, you know. So trying to like create reading and lectures is actually quite, it's enjoyable and challenging, but it's really difficult to do something that you exist within. And it's just a different, it sits outside of like Western frameworks of how learning should be.
I actually did my dissertation in uni, so I studied international relations and politics, and I did my dissertation on music as political activism, and it was focusing on three main albums. One was Beyoncé's Lemonade because it just came out. One was To Pimp a Butterfly, and the other was like an old sort of UK punk British one. And I had not a similar situation, because I'm like by no means an academic, but I went to quite a not posh university, but no one else had ever written about hip hop in the politics module, put it that way. And I thought I was going to have a really hard time, but Pete Burnham, my dissertation, what do you call him, supervisor, he just loved the idea, like really, really loved the idea. And I think that goes to show that it's undeniable once all the facts are there, and it's such a big culture, it can't not have lessons inside it. Do you know what I mean? It can't not have theories inside it.
I feel like I'm also doing dissertation. Like, I'm in the middle of writing my one. Well, I should be like finished right now. So my one, it's examining about, so it's about like in Brazil. So there's this music called funky music, which is like, you know, boom, cha, cha, boom, cha, cha. Everyone knows it as that. So it's kind of like a dance, but also like, it's basically their rap music. And it was created by black working class people living in these communities called favelas. And so, yeah, it was just exploring whether Baile Funky can be considered like a liberatory space for Black feminist thought. And with that as well, like with my dissertation supervisor, like she's completely, I love her, but she's completely unqualified. She told me, why don't you write your dissertation on like 19th century Brazilian literature? And I'm like,
she's not quite the same.
Yeah. I'm like 200 years ago, but yeah, like it's quite interesting, like with that as well, like also examining kind of Black feminist thought in hip-hop. And there's always this argument in hip-hop that if you are a woman, and particularly if you're a Black woman, because there have been numerous rappers who do say very misogynistic things, misogynoir particularly as well, as Black women, can we enjoy hip-hop? Like, what's your thoughts on that?
Yeah, without, I'm a Black woman and I love hip-hop. I grew up on hip-hop. I remember the first hip-hop song I heard was Onyx Slam in 93. And yeah, because we went to New York for the summer for the first time.
Oh my God.
My brother's like 10 years older than me. And like, he was just like, whoa, like, what is this? And we came back and that was like literally the song on repeat. Oh, no. Like, September. So like, that is, and I was about 6 years old. So that would have been like the first hip-hop song I heard. And I, yeah, that was the music that I grew up listening to due to my siblings and my mum as well. So I think that hip-hop, I mean, what the whole misogyny thing is that we always leave out that misogyny is white supremacist. And like with any culture we exist, it's a subsection, it's a byproduct of white supremacy. So yes, there is misogyny in hip-hop, but there's also misogyny in freaking rock songs, you know? Like, you hear some really heavy metal, they're talking about raping women and stabbing women who are pregnant. Mm-hmm. But we're not having that conversation.
Mm-hmm.
So any culture within a dominant culture is always going to absorb those value systems, and hip-hop is no different to any other genre of music.
Mm-hmm.
But I think because it's Black people, the attention is much more focused, because it plays into narratives that we are somehow more degenerate and we're, you know, more debased and, you know, these really kind of racist colonial stereotypes. So I think it's, that's like what needs to be unpicked, is hip-hop isn't any more sexist than any other music genre. Male rappers aren't any more sexist than like male rock singers or pop singers, you know?
And for you, Sophia, like, what was your first kind of connection with hip-hop, like when you was young, like your first experience with hip-hop culture or anything?
I remember my first experience of hip-hop culture is very different from my first experience with hip-hop. I think I grew up playing ball, and basketball as a wider culture when you're off court is very, especially when you're young and you're in an area like mine, it looks like hip hop culture a lot. So I think I learned a lot more about it before I could attach it to a genre or a sound. But I remember hearing, what was, Runaway Love? That was one of, it wasn't one of the first hip hop songs I heard, but it was the first time I had heard storytelling. I think, was it Ludacris? I can't remember. The Lil Lisa's Only 9 Years
Old. Yeah.
And it was like four different stories in this, like, one, maybe 6 minute song with a chorus. And I, as a poet before I was a poet, I loved that. I was like, wait, hang on. And there was a time for that. Like, there was in hip hop, I remember when I was that age and I was listening, these were the kind of things that were coming from the TV. A lot of the rap around me sounded like that, whether it was Sci-Hi the Prince telling like just a 6 minute story on a track. I grew up inside that side of hip hop more so than perhaps like club hip hop or dance hip hop or hip hop that is more explicitly unbalanced in terms of how and what they speak about things. But sort of going back to what you said, I was in New York a couple of days ago and I linked up with one of my friends there, and she lives in the Bronx and her family's lived in the Bronx forever. For a very long time they've been in the Bronx, and she works inside hip hop. She's a publicist. And the hip hop that their lifestyle was very much hip hop. This was completely new to me, but their reasoning and how they rationalize things in their day to day. So even when we're making decisions about the day, it's I wouldn't, maybe not hip hop per se, but it's the loudest part of their culture. When you're in the Bronx, it's the clothes, the food, the mannerisms, the rationale, of course, the music, how people reason with each other, how people communicate with each other. It all derives from this culture that's obviously so much more than a sound. And there was this female artist that she was showing me, and because she was having a birthday whilst I was there. And it was, she's like, I mean, their main rappers, obviously, Lil Kim, in terms of their, in the Bronx, female rappers, and a lot of female rappers have sort of derived from her in terms of style, dress, content. And it's become, because she's been there for so long, and she was obviously only like one person in a bigger culture, but it was so normal, like so normal. When I'm in London, I'm in obviously in a different space. I'm around, I'm at empowerment events all the time. And if you, like, you see my content, most of my content is to do with women, is to do with either self-empowerment or female empowerment, about closing the gaps in sort of internally in our own homes and our own conversations. So when I was there, it was such a shock to me, such, and it shouldn't have been, because I know it to exist. I know it to exist. It's just not something that's in my context at all. But it was just so normalized, like the way people were dressing, which isn't necessarily inherently wrong unless you know your why. But I think there was a massive lack of knowing why she's singing like this, or why the video looks like this, why she's bending like that. There was just a lack of the why. And I think if you've grown up and only seen a culture, and you've only been ingrained in one culture, and everyone around you is in that same culture, you don't naturally question the why. That's not your first thing to do until you're sort of pulled out from it, or you see something a little bit different, and then you're like, oh, actually. But they were, their roots were so, they'd been there, you know, they'd been there, and she was born into the Lil Kims, and she's then managed a whole bunch of artists since that are very much like her, and her family's in the same industry, and it's just, it was normal, like it was very normal. And I don't know how, let's say you've been in our land, let's say you've been in sort of a big family for ages, and you've got one thing that you do in your culture. So for example, breaking plates at a celebration, let's say that's something you've always seen to be normal and exist. You might just never question it at all. And then my question when I was there in New York the whole time was like, how obligated am I to try to tell you something's wrong or right when this is your smashing plates? Do you know what I mean? Unless you question your why personally, and I suppose all you can do is point someone in the direction of working out their why.
Can I ask, can you just tell me more, like, what was shocking, like, what was it that was just kind of
the video was a freestyle. It was the Box freestyle, which was a bunch of female rappers from New York, some like quite well known here, I think one or two that are quite well known here, but then the rest I'd never heard of. But in the video, it was like a big white room, and the different women, like, no one was really wearing like any clothes. And the video was, so for example, the rapper that she was managing had like a leather Tarzan type suit on, and she had two women on a leash by the neck in front of her, and she had like her foot on like one of their bums, and it was just feeding, I don't really know what it was feeding, but the whole video was sort of along that same vein. There was a lot of like animalistic references in the lyrics, and all the lyrics were just talking about sex, what they can do, what they expect their partners to do, which again, like, isn't inherently wrong, but it is, to me, it was just really shocking, like really shocking, because I hadn't seen it in ages. It just felt like so long since I'd actually been around female rappers, maybe, because even here, not as much.
And I think there's like quite a fine line, particularly with black women rappers, or any black women in the music industry, between what's hypersexualization and what's just them owning their sexuality. And it's always such a difficult question, and it's kind of like, you know, you have your people like Meg Thee Stallion, who I absolutely love her, but it's just like, you know, some people would also be critical of her and what she represents, and you know, she gets criticism for only talking about literally her vagina and how good she is at sex, you know what I mean? And people say she's being one-dimensional, but but then at the same time you have male rappers who literally only talk about sex. And I just wanted to ask you guys, do you think there's just this big double standard for the women in the music industry?
Definitely. I do feel like men are really interesting people, right?
Interesting.
Put it that way. And so on one hand, right, they want women to like respond to like sex and sexuality, but only within their confines, right? Within like what they want. And so sometimes when women step out, maybe it's like Meg Thee Stallion, or it's Foxy, or it's Cardi, or it's Nicki, or whoever, and it exists in their own kind of context, that's when it's like, they're doing too much.
Yeah.
It's too hypersexual, they're not respecting themselves. But hold on a minute, you're reproducing exactly the same kind of like visuals or language in your own music videos or in your own songs. And that's what I think is the double standard. It's like, well, you're okay with it when it's for you, but when it's a woman doing it for herself, even if she's still using the same sexist language, it's not okay. Mm-hmm. So it's about power. It's about like deciding women's sexuality and how women can be sexually active and how they express themselves, but only if it's for male pleasure, never for our pleasure. Like, we don't have pleasure.
Yeah.
And that's what I get really like. Like, even if sometimes I do disagree with it, I still think that women should have the space to be able to be overt with their sexuality. And I think especially black women, like, historically, there's been hypersexualization placed on our bodies. There's been other narratives of, like, our libidos being, you know, uncontrollable. So when we, like, reproduce that same language, it's a problem.
Yeah.
And I just don't think the same kind of language or the same kind of critique exists with, like, specifically black men and, like, phallic power and like how big their penis is and all that kind of stuff, because that's still a racist trope, that's a slavery trope, you know. So there's a very double-edged sword there.
I also think as well, like, it's also there is kind of the double standard again, who gets to who's deemed as being hypersexual. So you have someone who, like Meg Thee Stallion, you know, she, let's just say she's kind of like the she's got an ideal feminine body, you know, like she's slim but she's curvy, you know what I mean? Fat in all the right places to be really like vulgar about it. And then you have someone like Missy Elliott who raps about a lot of these kind of things. Like, literally, what did people think One Minute Man was about? You know, but Missy Elliott is never ever put in the same category as Meg Thee Stallion or Cardi B or someone. I don't know, what's your guys' thoughts on it? And particularly for you, Sophia, as well. Like, I think as well, like, for female rappers who kind of, I would give the example of maybe someone like No Name, who I absolutely love. And I know she comes from originally a spoken word background as well and kind of made the crossover. But I've kind of noticed that a lot of these kind of female rappers, like take a Lauryn Hill, for instance, or like a No Name, those ones who kind of adhere to kind of respectability politics in a sense, they're poets. They're not rappers. Do you think there's like a classism element as well, like in the world of poetry, like poetry and rap?
I mean, yeah, with any genre, even when you look at the inception of jazz, when people started doing free jazz, people were like, what is that? Like, what is this disorganized thing? And I think you get purists in anything, but I think what you said earlier between the thin line between someone being sexually liberated and then someone feeding a hypersexual sexualized culture, it's not actually a thin line, to be fair, it's just a blurry one. And sometimes the artist themselves isn't aware. And I remember having, when I was in New York and I was with my partner and we were having this conversation, and he's a black man, and we were talking about the hypersexualization of the black man compared to the hypersexualization of the black woman. And I was basically saying I wanted to start a lingerie line for married women, and that was my aim. And in terms of the marketing side of things, it would be, so my example to him was, there's a source and then there's output and then there's input. Input is the 16-year-old boys or girls that I work with. Output is what they're exposed to in the media, and the source is what the media creates. And they all exist in this cycle, and it's very, the brain of the output is very influenced by the source massively, which is why if you want to change the mindset, you have to change the source, which is what we're seeing in marketing now.
Mm-hmm.
And linking that into sort of the sexualization, it's showing different types of bodies, for example, or showing different colors in different spaces, but just reshaping the prejudice and ideas that you might have. And I think inside that, when linking it back to sort of the sexualization explicitly, where we've even said the main sexualized body of a black woman is like big hips, thin waist, big breast, long legs, whatever it might be, comparing that to how white women used to be sexualized, and how that fed this culture of anorexia, for example, in modeling and with young girls. And I think it's sometimes the artist doesn't know, because they're so far inside the source, or they're so far gone inside the output, they're not sure whether they're liberating themselves, or whether they're sexually liberating themselves, or whether they're feeding into a culture that is sexualized. I was in India a few weeks ago, and there was a panel discussion by women who write about sex and literature. And one of the women said that the first month of her being married, which was the first time she was having sex, she felt so much shame attached to bending in certain ways, moving in certain ways, making sounds, because she had grown up in Hindu culture where sex is a massive part of Hinduism, like a huge part of Hinduism.
Yeah.
But it's never spoken about with the girls growing up in Hinduism at all.
Wow, okay.
And the Kama Sutra, like...
Yeah, that's what I was about to say.
It's a massive part of the religion, but it's not something that the girls are encouraged to speak about, to explore anything of the sort. Whereas the men, it's a conversation, even my Hindu family, like the men, it's a conversation that you have at like maybe 13, 14, and you carry on having that conversation. And especially at 14, 16, when you're thinking of sex or sexualizing a woman's body, you might go to the Kama Sutra, but you're probably going to go to porn, or you're going to watch music videos, and that's what you see as a woman's sexual body. So when you then go into marriage, you've got this warped idea of what sex is. You've got this warped idea of what the woman's body is meant to do for you and how it's meant to pleasure you. And as a woman who's never been educated on sex prior to that because of the culture, then you get married at like 17, 18, 19, and you then have to perform for your husband. The only thing you've seen pertaining to sex is also the same media, is also the same porn. So she goes in with this mindset of, I need to perform for my husband. He goes in with this mindset of, my wife's body is, she's meant to perform for me. And they live like that, and they stay like that. So she was saying that her first sort of month or few months of marriage, she was so ashamed of her body because she was never encouraged to explore her sexuality. She was never encouraged to see her body as a sexual body or a sexual being at all. And that was brand new to her. And that obviously shaped sex and her marriage massively.
Mm-hmm.
And I say that to say, how do we, because this is something I still don't know, how do we encourage that sexual exploration of a body for girls in a society that breeds such a warped picture of a woman's body,
yeah,
or a warped picture of woman in the role of sex? I still don't know how at all. Like, even when I go into schools, I'm working with the younger girls, which I'd like do weekly, I'm still not completely sure, because you have to teach it with confidence, you have to teach it with liberation, you have to teach it with responsibility, but you can't stop what they see. They're exposed to the exact same people we see now. The 13-year-olds have got the same people on their Instagram feed that I do now, but they haven't got a level of sensitivity or responsibility or even confidence at that stage to separate that from themselves.
Yeah. And like, Janine, you said you worked, you did youth work for 10 years. And like, did you come across these themes with the young women that you worked with? Obviously, maybe they're too young for marriage, but even just in kind of relationships with their boyfriends and feeling like they have to perform in a certain way and adhere to certain kind of, I don't know, sexual images that he may have seen, their boyfriend may have seen on the internet. And how did you deal with that? How to answer kind of Sophia's question?
I mean, because I had my own girls group, wasn't in school, so it's a whole different context where you get to build relationships with young people over durational periods of time. And yeah, totally, those things came up. But I think it's important, what I know, one, being a young woman myself, like, we must always remember we were young women, and so we experience perhaps not so different things that young women nowadays experience, is that I still think that young women have the capacity to differentiate. So like, they're seeing all these images, yes, it's quite toxic, actually, and it does feed a particular kind of framing of how women should be. But at the same time, I still think young women, especially young women of colour, are able to like exist outside of that. Like, it's kind of doing, Bell Hooks calls it the oppositional gaze. So you can see things, you know you're not being represented, but you kind of able to exist outside of it at the same time. So you're doing these two things at once. And so, like, I remember, like, one of the girls asked me what Viagra was, and so I was just like, a man takes it for him to have a penis, keep his penis erect. And just like that matter of fact, not like giggling, and just like, okay, cool. And so I think, like, also it's how you deliver information. Like, if we, like you're saying, deliver it to confidence, deliver it factually, deliver it in a context that's also safe. I think young people are much more respectful and much more responsible than we probably really give them and take it credit for. And like, I know that some of the young women I were working was definitely having sex under the legal age of consent, and I can't stop them from doing that. But what I can do is tell you where to go and what resources you should be using, and whether you are actually having consensual sex, and what does consent actually really mean, boundaries, and all these other things that sits around engagement. But also, as a culture, we don't know what intimacy means. Like, we associate intimacy with sex, we don't associate intimacy with friendships. We don't associate, like, our fixation is a very, like, heterosexual, romantic coupling framework. We don't think about other ways to be loving, other ways to touch, other ways to be intimate, other ways to express our desires that isn't necessarily always sexualized. So we have a wider culture that doesn't actually educate us, or we're not seeing visuals that shows different types of desiring framework. And then when we do, it's a very heterosexual coupled framework. So but also dealing with that, and then underneath that you have the whole pornographic, highly sexualized visuals, and so it's all a big mess. And I think for me, the most important thing is, like, how do I build intimacy with you two sitting right next to me? What does that look and feel like? Is it okay to touch you? Kind of, you know, like, how do we build these language, like, every single day? So we do have romantic context, it's just like part of our norm. And I think for me, like, when I was working with young women, like, that was the biggest thing, like, building intimate, caring language every day, so that even if it's just our space, that's the space that exists in, whether it doesn't translate anywhere else, whatever, but...
You need that.
Yeah, you need that.
Definitely, because you're up against a monster. Like, you're up against such a monster, especially kids now. Like, sometimes I'm just at a loss when I go into school, because I'm just... You're seeing me for X amount of hours a week, but you spend way longer than that on your phone. You spend way longer than that. And I think what I found recently, and this is something I even speak about in my book a little bit, because it happened to me, but now they're up against a bigger monster. I remember when I was in school, there was a guy I had a crush on, and I was such a tomboy was just the thing. And so we were really close friends. But the girls that I saw that he fancied, they looked a certain way. They had started going through puberty already and I hadn't. So when I came back the following summer and I felt like my almonds were like mangoes and I had some hips, I was like, I can't wait for PE. Like, I can't wait to get into the shirt. I can't wait to get in some shorts. And it didn't bang for me anyway, but that was such an example of how we see ourselves in comparison to things. And now, as a 14, 15 year old, a very natural feeling, like a crush or liking someone, you might look to the kind of music they consume or the videos they consume, see the woman that they're attracted to, and that is your immediate sense of comparison. You're comparing yourself to, like, let's say they do watch Meg Thee Stallion or Maya Jama, whoever it might be, that's your immediate point of comparison. And definitely I'm not giving, like, young girls enough credit, because their discernment at this age is, I personally think a lot better than a lot of my friends' discernments when we were young, just because they're encouraged to critically think, because they see a zillion opinions a day. But then also, not all young people are exposed to that either, because it still can be very unhealthy. Like, Instagram is a wormhole. You control your content, but it kind of feeds you essentially whatever you eat, especially if you're not trained social media in terms of what's safe for your actual mental and what's not, what's safe for your confidence, what's not. So I think we have these spaces where we work with these young girls, and we can be a point of care, or a point of at least conversation, or at least empathy or compassion or understanding. But that's still the minority of girls, and the majority of young girls are exposed to this monster, which is the media. And it's, I don't know. I just feel for feel for the new gen.
Yeah, and I think like you both touched on points as well, like again creating those intimate bonds with fellow women, femmes, and the importance of that, because obviously we've got all these, like, you know, not only just patriarchy and stuff like that, and just other factors such as Instagram and those kind of images that you're endlessly, like, particularly as a young person, and you may be susceptible to being influenced by this. And so I just wanted to ask you guys, what are some, like, femmes or any kind of spaces that you found that have been, like, really amazing to your creative growth, that you've been able to find kind of intimacy or love and care, if that makes sense?
These are two online spaces, actually. So one's called Rihanna Jade Park, Bum Babylon.
Oh, I love that.
It's a great space. And then the other one is by Bola Tajuddin, which is Art in the Age of Black Girl Magic. What's that group? It's about over, like, 100 black women, creative of all kinds, and it's amazing. And we're just, like, constantly dialoguing every day. And my friend Dre, she does amazing healing spaces and events. And so I feel like the black women, perhaps, it goes back to your point about, like, what's in your context, what's who are you orbiting around. So the black women that I'm lucky to be orbiting around are, like, organizing exponentially. Like, I think in the last, like, I don't know, 5 years, we're seeing, like, you know, Galdem got Born and Bred, you got BBZ, you got all these Purple Rain Collective, like, all these different, mainly also queer collectives as well, like, that needs to be very, like, articulated. Organizing exponentially, and I'm like, what are the men doing? Like, what are the black boys doing? Like, I'm actually kind of concerned. I'm genuinely, seriously concerned. I'm like, I'm seeing black women, like, and black femmes and black queer folks organize and create spaces and be in community, and I'm like, but what are our brothers doing? Like, who are they going to? Like, how is this operating? Because I'm, like, low-key, high-key concerned. Like, how are they being in dialogue with each other? And I just don't feel like the framework of, like, liberation around patriarchy, around heterosexuality, isn't going to change if black men aren't in dialogue with each other. Where are they getting their cues from? Like, who are they reading? Like, you know? So I am like, okay, it's great that we're doing this stuff, but, like, what's happening on the other side as well?
You're so right. When I think of the sort of black female movements that I've seen take off over the past 2 years, like, whether it's, like, Black Girl First or Girl I can't think of an actual male
equivalent
at all. My situation with my context has become a lot more complicated since I started working in music a lot. I think when I was just poetry is quite a nurturing art form, and it creates quite nurturing spaces. And I was in, like, the inception of, like, Galdem and BBN, like, these were sort of the spaces I was operating in, performing in, writing press for, like, these kind of spaces. And then as I got into music, it becomes more visual than internal, firstly. And a lot of the group, let's say group chats that I'm in for music, they, I don't have to explain it other than saying they're very visual based. So if they are uplifting you, they're uplifting you about a photo you just posted. It won't necessarily be the content of what you might have said in the caption or whatever it might be. So it's more like that. But also it's a very R&B and hip hop space that I'm in. A friend of mine, Kenny Amaphadon, he just does a lot for the community and bringing people together. And 3 years ago, he wanted a group around him of people from different industries, different walks of life, to have a space for dialogue and responsible dialogue and sharpening each other. And a Christian group as well was what he wanted, but he didn't have one, so he made one. So he got 18 girls in Parliament and he got 18 guys, and we meet separately. And for 3 years, we've been meeting separately every few months, and now we have our socials, and he's been creating the same roster for 3 years now. So now he's got three groups of the three different 18 women and 18 men, and he's created this that gave me a sisterhood that I never really, I knew I needed, but I didn't know in what form. And it's women from different industries, so a lot of women in PR, a lot of women in production, theatre, music, obviously it's a Parliament group, so a lot of people in politics, but it's just created this ironing sharpening iron thing. And there's there's few things more uplifting than a sisterhood and a nourishing sisterhood. There's few things that can build the context of a woman more than another woman sort of speaking into you, or when a man's doing it properly, like when a woman's speaking into a man properly and a man speaking into a woman properly, and they come together, that's an incredible thing as well. But yeah, no, what you said about there not being men's spaces, that is quite concerning, because in a dualist world, we need them to be okay as well.
Yeah,
we
yeah.
need them to be cool, yeah. otherwise, what are we doing?
Yeah, 100%. As well, like, again, like we've spoken about the internet. Without the internet, we wouldn't have had these spaces, because, you know, I mean, I grew up in London, you guys grew up in London as well. So we're quite fortunate that we're in a space where we're surrounded by Black people on a daily. We go to school with them, go to work with them, just literally just even just passing by another familiar face. And for those people who live in, you know, the more remote parts of the country or smaller cities and don't have that kind of community, you know, the internet is vital. It's that key. And I also think as well that people sometimes like to look down on, like, you know, always say like the internet is just this horrible place and it's so toxic and stuff. And it's just like, yo, like without the internet, stuff like Black Lives Matter wouldn't be able to happen. Me too. Like all of these kind of these social movements. And so for you, how was the internet so instrumental in your kind of like your career taking off?
I'm 33, so I'm pre that generation where the internet really worked for them. So it didn't actually take my but being able to witness those who are younger than me, that is brilliant. So I have to be very honest, like I was doing events when there was no Instagram and we weren't really on Twitter and we weren't really posting it on Facebook. Like it was just happening and people like spoke to each other. Like no, but real, like that's how I was when I used to do like female hip hop nights. That's how it was rolling. Like it'll be like 5 people and then the next thing it'll be like 10 people and it'll just naturally grow. And I was doing that for like 3 years or so, and other people in the scene, shout out DJ Snar, who kind of like was like, okay, I see what you're doing. Yeah, you're right, we need to change, like, you know. So yeah, I'm a, like free all of how it's organizing. I wasn't part of that generation, so I can't speak for myself. But I feel like being able to see like younger women, Black women, young women of color, being able to organize in that way, I think it's bloody brilliant, because it's on an international level. Like you're seeing collaborations happen, you're seeing people physically, you know, you were saying you was in Brooklyn the other day connecting with someone. Like it's amazing to see those global networks, and it's something that I didn't necessarily had, like maybe on a national level, but yeah.
And like for you, Sophia, like obviously you're a poet and then now you've got your book coming, like is it coming out or
came out
oh my October. God I'm so, yeah, yeah.
No, that's cool thank you.
Number one, let's just plug your book.
Thank you.
Please plug your book.
Get it from, is it an online order,
it's all of the above. So it's online on like Waterstones, Amazon, Foils, it's offline as well. I'll be really quick, but yeah, Somebody Give This Heart a Pen, it's a poetry collection on the universal tendencies of the heart, mostly looking at family and love and loss, I think are the main themes. To answer your question really quickly as well about the internet, so I'm 24, so I came out as of recently, so I was sort of working in this space of the internet massively, not necessarily for the first like maybe 16 to 18 those years as much, because it wasn't really something we were using for events massively. But after that, I think it forced me to decide what kind of artist I wanted to be in terms of responsibility, because the wake of the internet and instant gratification and low attention spans, we think less. Like we just think less about what we post, how we communicate, if we're communicating. Do we miss sentiment? Do we not miss sentiment? Are we missing touch, for example? We don't even realize that we haven't hugged someone in however long. So I think that made me realize, okay, I want to talk about things that will slow people down. I want to talk about the importance of slowing down. But yeah, the internet was good for that.
Okay. I think we're going to have to wrap it up there, guys. It's been wonderful having you both on. You're also basically our first actual guest on our podcast. So this is like a momentous moment. Ooh. And I'm so happy it's like two other Black women, because big up, we need to be everywhere, on everyone's screens, in your ears, everywhere. But yeah, so check out the I'm Hip Hop podcast, follow us on all the socials, which will be down below in the description. description box. Janine, Sophia, would you like to plug your socials, get them, get that engagement up?
You can follow me on Instagram and Twitter, and it's at @itsjaninebtw.
Instagram and Twitter, not much happens on Twitter though, just get the book. It's got everything.
Buy
there.
The book, guys.
But yeah, Sophia Tarkle on Instagram and YouTube.
Okay, great, and thank you for having us. Bye.